Thank you. Before I start, I'm the kind of the last full speaker. I just want to thank all the volunteers and everybody that put this together. Let's give them a big round of applause. With a show of hands, how many of you spend about 2 hours a week sitting in bumper-to-bumper traffic? Wow, that's pretty good. That's the amount of time the average Floridian now spends in traffic here in South Florida. It's increased by 30% since COVID. We're now ahead of Los Angeles, and there's only 7 other regions in the world that have worse traffic than South Florida. Okay, another show of hands. How many of you think that housing prices here are just outrageously expensive? Okay, that's a little better, I guess. And for my final question, how many of you think that I could get elected mayor of any community here in South Florida if my platform were to increase housing density by 500% in order to solve our housing and transportation problems? I didn't think so. It's counterintuitive. But increasing housing density and creating walkable, sustainable communities is an important part of the solution to solve our housing and our transportation problems. Urbanist and best-selling author Richard Florida wrote that low-density suburban sprawl was the cause of the Great Recession. He noted that after the Great Recession, the places that would be thriving and in high demand by the market would be denser, walkable communities that are creative, artistic places. We see that here in downtown Delray. We have used 90% of the budget that was set forth in the Paris Climate Agreement for carbon emissions if we want to keep within a 1.5 degree global temperature rise. It's not looking likely that that's going to happen. Most scientists now think that we're probably going to see 2 to maybe as much as 3 degrees within our lifetimes. So we need to create climate-resilient neighborhoods that can withstand extreme weather. And living here in South Florida, we all know what that's like. I recently visited the Bonn neighborhood in Grenoble, France. It's a wonderful place, one that I would want to live. People walk, bike, they use transit, they drive electric vehicles. The buildings are solar powered and they subtract carbon emissions from the atmosphere because they generate more power than the building consumes, so it feeds the grid. Between the buildings is green spaces and playgrounds. This is a photo of my son on the ropes course. There's cafes, and they have a species that is almost extinct in the United States, the bookstore. Do you guys all work for Amazon? 23 years ago, I went to Paris and visited a friend. We borrowed bikes and rode around for 3 days. It was a memorable experience, but at the time, Paris was not a safe place to bike. The roads were dangerous, and you felt like you were taking your life into your hands. This past summer, I went back to Paris and also visited Grenoble and Barcelona and went to the United Kingdom. I was studying the urban fabric and transportation systems in these cities. I'm a professor at Florida Atlantic University in urban planning, and I have been on sabbatical, and I'm a visiting scholar at the Transport Studies Unit in the School of Geography and the Environment at the University of Oxford. Paris is a radically different city. The people are friendly now. Maybe a lot of French people in this audience too. But French have a good sense of humor, so. It is very bicycle friendly as well. This is a photo of my son biking in a tunnel that used to be for cars and trucks, but it has been converted for people who want to run and bike and ride on rollerblades and skateboards. This is not an isolated example. This is all over Paris. Amsterdam and Copenhagen are places that people know for being, you know, bicycle meccas, but Paris is remarkable because it rivals those cities, and it's a much larger city population-wise. This got me thinking, you know, why can't we do this here in South Florida and across the United States? I mean, could you imagine if the mayor of Miami announced that we're going to take the streetscape away from lots of car lanes and devote it for bicycling and light rail? People would go up in arms. They would say, we have too much traffic. We're too crowded. We can't do that. Well, in fact, this actually happened all that long ago in West Palm Beach, where I live. It was very controversial. But in my research, I found that cities in France and Europe are 5 times more dense than American cities, and cities in the UK are 2 to 3 times denser. So imagine Paris with all of the nasty traffic that they had that I experienced 20 years ago, with 5 times the population density, and they still took away that space from vehicles and devoted it over to sustainable modes. This is because they're trying to achieve their climate goals of carbon reduction. We need to build more light rail and more housing. We need to convert our streets. This is an image from Barcelona. This also used to be a wide street for vehicles, and it's now being converted into a complete street where more of the space is allocated for light rail and bicyclists. This is an image of incorporating nature-based solutions into our streetscapes. A bioswale goes along a new bike lane, and what that allows for is a green sponge to soak up the heavy rains that are now becoming more prevalent because of our changing weather patterns. Some say that AI could be a solution to these problems, and I have a lot of hope for AI. I mean, AI can make our cities more efficient, utilize our resources more efficiently and effectively. For example, we could potentially grow more landscaping with less water, utilize energy from renewable resources with better efficiencies. My colleagues and I recently got a grant at Florida Atlantic University from the National Science Foundation to establish the Center for Smart Streetscapes. This is creating a test bed in West Palm Beach and other cities around the country to look at how we can use innovative AI technologies to make our streets and our cities more responsive and resilient and intelligent. But AI is not the magic bullet solution to our problems. The solution is politically unpopular, and it's counterintuitive for most people. We need to build more light rail, and we need to allow for developments of housing and jobs around those stations. We need to convert our streets to allow for more sustainable modes like cycling and light rail and other modes. We see that Richard Florida was correct. Downtown Delray, we have seen luxury developments that have been popping up. but these are very expensive and not very attainable for most working class people. There are two hurdles that we need to overcome. One is NIMBYism. There's a lot of great projects that are proposed that get shot down by NIMBYs, but recently, the state of Florida legislature unanimously passed the Live Local Act, which attempts to create more affordable housing. I don't know if you guys heard what I just said, but I said the legislature unanimously passed something. You know, housing is a major crisis if in any states, Florida, the two political parties can agree on something, on anything. The Live Local Act mandates that multifamily projects must be approved if they contain 40% affordable housing in commercial areas. They could be as tall as the tallest building within a 1 mile radius. The other problem, the other hurdle that we need to overcome is our transportation system. It is overly auto dependent. It generates way too much carbon emissions. So we need to build upon the solid bones that we have with the Bright Line and the Tri-Rail. And we need to be able to connect not just the downtowns along the coast, but we need to go inland towards the suburban areas to the west of our communities. After World War II, we started building highways. That created a ripple of suburbs that led to a tsunami of carbon emissions and climate change. A new idea was born in the 1800s in England called the Garden Cities Movement that spread to Europe and Japan during the 20th century to create these more sustainable, walkable communities. That wave is now spreading here to the United States. But if we're going to do something about global warming, we need to move quickly. We need to build housing. We need to rethink our transportation system. And to address the extreme weather, we need to build resilience into our neighborhoods and our housing. If we do these things, then just maybe we might prevent the bookstore from becoming extinct. Thank you.